Anglinger is actually a little bit alone, because it seems that there are not so many people are doing this kind of topic that is about the urban informal settlement, which is actually, of course I could understand that everybody has their own priority and interest, but I think that this topic is going to be, or it is already very, very important, especially in the developing countries, where we have always a problem with the, you know, very continuous rural urban migration, and where the local government doesn't have the ability and also the support funding to do anything about it. So I really hope that somewhere in the future there will be more research will be done about this topic in this faculty. And if I understand quite well, then Vincent already mentioned that he's going to start as well a center for developing
development studies.
Well, anyway, it's going to be in that department as well. So what I'm going to talk first briefly about my research, and just talk touch briefly about the research question, studies and conclusions, and what is my research activities, and also the possible future research. Well, I think basically most of you are quite familiar with the term of the informal settlements. Basically, when we are talking about this, then we have many colleagues from different Latin American cities. So it could be, you know, existing in the name and the form of favela, like in Brazil, kampung, like in Indonesia, or the gerekondu in Turkey, and as a premier irregular somewhere in Colombia, also in Peru. I think it's mentioned also under that name. But of course, all of these settlements, they have different cultural form, cultural setting. It is also influenced by different social, economic, and political driving forces. Even though they are all different, but it seems that they have more or less the same red line, what is the same characteristic, is that normally the settlement, they have low quality of living standards. So basically, they have very poor basic infrastructures and hygiene, and also they have not so good public and social facilities. You mean because they are being informal, they are not very well recognized politically, and also to the other extent socially by the city itself. So the problem is always resulting from the they are disintegrated from the main structure of the city. So basically, if I can summarizing, settlement, informal settlement is a settlement without a form of planning, because it kind of happens sporadically. It's not never been formed or planned before. And normally this settlement doesn't have a property ownership, tenorship, which is really the main problem of the informal settlement, because just think about it, if you have a house or a place that you live in and you don't have the title of the place, of course people are not very stimulated, and they're not really willing to spend or invest the money to make improvement of the house. Because in any second you think that somebody is going to take over your house and you're going to be evicted from the house, so why really bother investing in your living environment? And normally, also the other characteristic is the settlement, they're normally located in the brownfield areas, the non-livable areas, which is not supposed to be used as a settlement habitation. For example, along the railway, or under the bridges, or along the river banks, and basically kind of areas that is have a very high level of environmental risk. Okay, I think I already touched on this as well. So the urban informal settlement is normally located in cities in developing countries where there are still gaps in the governance, where this kind of informal settlement are possible to appear, to take place. Because there is also known as the social housing scheme. So all the poor, they don't know where to live. Basically all the poor rural immigrants coming from the countryside, they come to the city looking for better economic possibilities. With no skills, and basically, of course, they cannot really integrate themselves to the formal economic sector. So what can they do is doing a very kind of simple economic activities that don't really need a lot of or a high level of education to skill. So being poor, of course, they kind of have a better option, so they have to look for this kind of alternative. So what I'm aiming to do with this research is I'm trying to really highlight that I'm trying to argue here that kampung is not only a settlement for the urban poor, because it's not really giving housing, kind of alternative housing for the urban poor. But what I would really like to argue is that kampung itself is a dynamic and a very resilient economic entity. And it is also, it's not isolated, but very well integrated to the formal sector as well. And I'm going to explain a little bit later about this. This is actually my study case area. It is my study case I took in Jakarta, which is the capital of Indonesia. Big metropolitan with around 22 million population in the whole metropolitan region. And of course, we have really a lot of problems with this kampung issues. And most of the kampungs are actually located in between the formal structure of the city itself. So, for example, as you have in the city district area, it could be located just side by side. So, you can really very stark economic contrast between the two. And because of that, for example, here, I don't have to give an overview of the city, but anyway, just to give you an idea, this is the location of the informal settlement that I'm taking. I'm taking interest in, and along and around it, all the civil districts, and also the garden city, the colonial garden city, and the political center, and also the trading center, and along this is. Which is the most important economic center in the city. So they are located just here. And because of the factor of this location, there are some common trajectories that we can find in this case, that they are, the kampung itself is called Chapel, and but they're also taking benefit from the situation. And because it's located in a very high value area, so normally in this kind of economic activities and the other, they are normally subject to very high tax of income and equity. But of course, being located in this kind of area, they are not serving as very good balance because they don't have very high level of production. Being located also in that place, they have actually great accessibility to the source of employment. But of course, being located there doesn't mean they have all the people who live here have the skill to join the formal sector. So because they are mostly low skilled and they have very low capital. So what they are doing is basically they doing capturing possibilities from the formal sector, informal sectors. That is by providing low cost and informal services and goods for the formal sector. So of course, being located in this kind of a situation, and we have to ask ourselves, so what is actually the future of the urban kampung? Are they really subjected to always be the loser of the situation because they are going to be evicted at any time? And the research question of I'm dealing with three questions. It is what is the role of the kampung in the metropolitan center, whether they are only accommodation of the poor, or they are also giving employment to the poor. And the second is what is the interaction between the kampung and the city? Because if you are going to tackle the issue of the kampung, you have to see what is the interaction between this area and the city itself, to put it into context. So whether they are threatened or benefiting, what is the relation, the interaction between the two, how is this kind of interaction, the relationship is influencing the spatial transformation.